with you around that topic. So that's really how I came at VC, and you know, it's been an interesting and wonderful ride so far.
Thank you. And where do you work now?
So I'm a venture partner at 500Startups.
All right, my turn. Brian Dixon, nice to meet everybody. I had a chance to chat. We kind of saw the 65-inch screen over here, so I'm excited to learn more about what that's all about. But Brian Dixon, partner at Kapor Capital, received stage in that investment fund. And I joined in 2011. How did I get there? I started a custom sneaker company at 16. Had no clue what a startup was, just really liked sneakers, and I was selling them on eBay and learned HTML. Kind of went to grad school or undergrad and focused on computer science, and always loved building things, kind of working with founders, kind of while in class, just thinking about ideas, what I want to do when I get out of class type of deal. I started a company kind of right after undergrad, and it was interesting because I had no clue about fundraising. I didn't even know about VCs or angels or any of that. And we did a business plan competition, got second place. And I remember we got a trip out here and it was like a TechCrunch party. And I came out to Silicon Valley from New York, Boston. And I was like, this is something I want to do. Obviously running a company, raising angel money, I learned how to pitch. So I've been hopefully in everybody's shoes in the audience of kind of getting up to speed. And then I went to grad school and got an intern at Kapor Capital 6 years later. Here we go.
Awesome. Good stories. Now, I know that many of you probably think about, I think about this as an entrepreneur, that one day I'm going to tell this story, and I get really excited about this as part of the story. So I can definitely see how your progression and obviously some of those milestones that you've met may support the work you do now and maybe the input you have towards entrepreneurs having the time yourself. So there's a secret to VC funding and fundraising, and there's a strategy to that. Tell us about what you have found that strategy to be or that secret to be. Maybe we can start with you, Brian.
Sure. So I think starting this conversation off, VC funding is not success. Building a successful business is success. And I think sometimes that just gets lost in the message of, you want to raise money, I always want to raise money, everybody wants to raise money, and you forget to build a business. So kind of kick it off kind of with that.
So there's the secret to it?
No, the secret. So one of the things I guess is quote unquote a secret is just understanding the process. So I think entrepreneurs who end up raising money, they have a list of all of the VCs, who they want to pitch to, and kind of why they're a good fit. They check, are there any conflicts in their portfolios? They identify people in their networks to actually do warm intros to those VCs. And they have like the team put together, they have the product, they have the traction, and then it's like going through and running, just like you run sales pipeline, it's running kind of your VC pipeline. That's one thing I think most entrepreneurs probably don't know or don't do, and they should probably.
That's what it's being done successfully. It's not usually done that
way. Yes, yeah. That's what it's a secret, I guess.
Yeah.
And so to Brian's earlier point, I think that, you know, I would also echo his point that not every business needs to have VC funding or should be a VC-backed business. And I think that before you run out there and start raising money, you should really think very clearly about what kind of business you want to build and be very pragmatic about what kind of business you have. And figure out if it's actually a VC-backed business or not. And so I don't think, there aren't a lot of secrets, but there are a lot of things that people don't know. And so I think that, you know, one of the things that people do is sometimes they're focused on the wrong types of VCs for the company they're running and for the stage that they're at. And so I would encourage people to just get better at really drilling down into a smaller number of VCs who you should be talking to. Because often, you know, if a VC comes to talk to me about, we invest really broadly, so this is really hard. But you know, if you're talking to a VC who only invests in B2B SaaS companies and you're a consumer internet company, that's probably a bad fit, and they might take the meeting, but that's really a waste of your time. So really figure out what a VC is interested in. If you've seen them writing about AI and you have an AI company, then that's a clear fit. If you've never seen them writing or tweeting, or you don't see anything in their portfolio that really fits, or you don't have any clues or signals that they're interested in what you're interested in, then that might not be a fit for you. So I think it comes down to doing a little bit more legwork and a little bit more upfront research before you go out and try to start raising money.
So when Brian was actually laying down the process, right, and like some of those secrets, most of the strategy of fundraising he mentioned, and then there's all these mistakes. So maybe we can talk a little bit about what are some of the mistakes you see that happen on a regular basis, right? So there may be some mistakes that you see that if people just knew a little more, right, to get in front of you, to be successful in front of you, what would be three things that you would say, if you could do these three things right now to change the outcome of your meeting with us, this would be those three things.
I would say, one, write a good email. Please repeat that, like write a good email. I see so many emails that have, hey, I have this idea and I'd love to meet with you. And that's it. And just because of the volume of emails that most investors get, that's just not going to get a good response. So really optimize your emails for getting a really good response rate. So I would say that a good email has, a reason why you're emailing me, some information about your company and the market you're trying to address, what your traction is, and what you want right now. If you're raising a round, go ahead and say that. The second mistake is not having a good handle on your metrics. So not understanding what your business unit economics are, not understanding what your LTV is, what your CAC is, really not having a handle on the numbers behind your business is a real red flag for a lot of investors. And then third,
my number one, which is, there's a lot of things you can do that you don't need money to do. You don't need $1 million to figure out a team. So have the team, have the CTO, have the hopefully product. And I think one common mistake is it's just too early. Hey, this is interesting. But there's nothing built here, and there's really nothing to invest in, not even the team, so half the team. I think the product, I feel like really no company gets it right on the first chance. You've got to be able to pivot and iterate quickly. So product, and not just building a product of like, hey, we're a pre-launch product, but we've built the product and here's some initial traction. It doesn't have to be thousands of people, it could be hundreds of people, but they're super engaged. They actually like this thing, they find value from it. It shows that, okay, there's probably something here. I think knowing kind of how much you're raising. We're a seed stage fund, we invest between 100, 250K, we make 20 investments per year. If you're raising $5 million, not a good fit. If you're raising 250K, not a good fit. The average size of investment is anywhere from $1 million to $2 million. So that's kind of the round size where we get involved and we think we could probably be the most helpful.
Thank you. I forget the microphone issue.
I do too. Sorry.
No worries. So I think I'm probably going to be sick tomorrow because I just realized we're sharing.
Yes.
I should have let him sit on that side. So I'll always remember Monique. So tell us about, I've heard you talk a little bit about the mistakes. I've heard you also say things like, even when I sat in front of you both thinking about what needs to happen next is that you should surround yourself with people that outside of that mentor within the VC can check the process for you and understand whether or not you're going in the right direction. But Before I move forward and ask you more questions about process or focus, I want both Brian and Monique to understand who's in the audience, and then we can tailor the question and the answer to make sure that we're meeting your needs. So how many entrepreneurs are here that are actively raising? Okay. And then I'm assuming that the rest of you are, or maybe investors in the house? No competition, so that's good. How about just people in general that just want to learn about the VC world or are here to support some of the startups? Okay, we have a lot of support. So for the support system, it's interesting to understand in terms of going around options. If there are options that they may not know about, some of us understand VC and then look at you and say, like, this is my only option. So I need money, I need to raise money from VCs. What are alternatives that entrepreneurs should be thinking about in order to make that next step? And that next step could be the team, right? Not everyone's gonna wanna do it for free. So how do they get the funds to make it happen? So
So I'll start off, this crowdfunding. You think about Indiegogo, kind of Kickstarter, more so for hardware products. So if you have a hardware product, that's one way to kind of show some traction. Hey, we can't build this thing because we need $1 million to actually build hardware. But what we can show is that there's a demand in the market, and that people have voted with their dollars in their wallet, actually have prepaid for a product that's not out today. So that's one way, I think, for hardware startups. You can kind of show some traction, some proof points there. Title III funding, I think that's still really early. And I think that even, we're investors in AngelList. There's Gust and there's a bunch of crowdfunding platforms out there. I think those platforms are great for when you have some traction and you're kind of, you have 750K, you're raising $1 million, and you want to kind of top off the 250. But I don't think it's a good platform for, I'm just getting started, I need to raise $1 million and I'm going to go on AngelList and it's going to happen. Because that's not how it really works, and that's not how it actually happens.
I would say, let's not discount bootstrapping a company for a while until you get to the point where you actually need VC funding, where you're ready for VC funding. I find a lot of companies or a lot of founders coming to VCs a little too early when they have an idea of a company that they want to start. I have an idea and I need $100,000 to hire a team. Well, that's just not the reality of the situation anymore, of the funding environment anymore. So I would say, figure out ways to bootstrap, trade equity for work from, a CTO or, a team. While you build a really good, decent MVP and get some traction, and then go out and start trying to raise VC money rather than going out prematurely and spinning your wheels for a really long time, you could be working on your product and getting something out there into the hands of customers.
So what's most important to you when you get an entrepreneur that actually has built something? Is it best, or you invest more in first to market, or someone who's already actually built a market or a proven market?
Well, I guess the second point, if somebody who's built a proven market, for like at least at seed stage, like you really don't see that. I think what you're looking for is there's something that you haven't seen every day. It's tackling a situation. Like we invested in a company, for example, called Swing. Everybody who's gone to school has a substitute teacher. What this company does, they say, hey, your fifth grade math teacher is out. We're going to replace the fifth grade math teacher with another math teacher who teaches fifth grade. That just makes sense. And we're going to do it where substitute teachers right now get robocalls kind of in the morning, like 6 a.m., 5 a.m., etc. We're going to send text messages and bring this on email. And the last problem is that when you go into a class as a substitute teacher, you have no context of like the students, where they're at with the curriculum, et cetera. And we're gonna give you the curriculum via text message, et cetera, before you even step foot in the class. It's like, that sounds amazing, right? And substitute teachers have been around for forever and they have kind of a different spin on it. And by the way, it's kind of a Uber model in a sense where they pay teachers and they take a 20% fee. But the good news is they get them higher salaries than what they would have gotten if they were just kind of a general sub. So they also increase the prices because of the value add. And it's all those combinations of like, I would never come up with that. And like, I've never seen anything like that. And this is why entrepreneurship is amazing.
Yeah.
And I think that's what you're kind of looking for. Like, I think we looked at 3,000 deals last year. We did 14. And out of the 14, and one of them is here in EarnUp, I saw you guys setting up, are like, they're doing something where you're like, that's really special, and I want to learn more. Like, if you're chasing that at VC, chances are that's not the right feeling you should get. And trust me, I've pitched, I've got a lot of those. You're going to get a lot of those. But the ones that are aligned and you want to work with, they're going to chase you down. It's going to be a partnership and not, hey, can I get another meeting?
Thank you. So now that everyone's racing, right? Like, this is now a global thing. It's no longer Silicon Valley. You have to come and travel to figure out the system or understand where you fit within the ecosystem. But now that it's a global outlook and everyone's racing everywhere, what do you think is something to consider as an entrepreneur when competition now became or is an issue, even if you're, you know, in close proximity to Silicon Valley?
Well, can you repeat the question?
So the global outlook, now that everyone's racing, right, there's higher competition, you can race anywhere, everywhere, but primarily Silicon Valley remains that hub. For entrepreneurs here or watching, what do you think it's up outlook and what should they be thinking about as they approach VCs?
Well, I think that just because, you know, yes, you can raise money from everywhere technically, but the truth of the matter is that most entrepreneurs still raise money in a very limited geography. So yes, there is a lot of international money flowing, but you know, most of the deals still get done in Silicon Valley, and then, you know, a lot of entrepreneurs raise in their own backyard, whether that's in New York or some other market, or, you know, LA is certainly hot right now. You know, we're very long LA. So I think there's a lot of opportunity for people to raise money in places outside of Silicon Valley. So I don't think that Silicon Valley necessarily has to be the be-all and end-all for a lot of entrepreneurs. I think there are really great ecosystems being built in Atlanta, Miami, New York, DC. I think there are lots of other places where entrepreneurs can find success. And so I don't think that they should feel that everyone has to move to Silicon Valley in order to be a successful startup. I think not being in Silicon Valley sometimes offers you certain advantages. Certainly talent may be cheaper. Just the cost of starting and running a company may be a little bit less. So I think that, you know, that old feeling of I have to move to Silicon Valley, or that old investor feeling of I only invest, you know, an hour plane ride from my office that's on Sand Hill Road, I think, you know, that there's still a lot of opportunity out there for founders who are not based here and who still want to raise capital.
I second that answer.
Thank you. And in terms of our political climate, what do you think is, you know, if I was to say what's the general picture, what should we be thinking about moving forward? How is raising changing, or will it change, or think it's going to change, given, again, our political climate?
Well, it's already changed. So I don't think we're waiting for it. It's happened already. You know, yeah, I'll give an example. So we have a healthcare company, kind of raising, or they had a term sheet. The term sheet got pulled. It's connected with Obamacare. Obamacare is getting repealed. I don't know if folks that want to put in $10 million into a system, they don't know what the new system is going to be replaced with. So that's a real-world example, and the company wasn't able to raise. So now it's kind of a bridge situation, going back to existing investors and trying to figure it out. I think you're going to see the same thing in education. You know, as you kind of have this shift towards a voucher program, etc. What does that mean for edtech companies that sell to school districts, public school districts, where funding is getting cut there? So I think this is just the start. You know, fundraising in general is hard, right? Like, I don't think that because of who we have as president, it's made it harder in some ways. I think it's changed a lot, but it's never easy. Like, I haven't met entrepreneurs like, yeah, I ran a raise a seed, it was easy. It doesn't happen, right? And especially with the Series A rounds, it really tightened up last year. I think the bar was just higher of what you need before you could raise $1 million a Series A with $1 million run rate. That's moved up to about $1.5 million, too. And, you know, it's kind of some of it's our fault as investors. Seed stage investors look more like Series A investors. Series A is looking more like Series B. But I think the president we have doesn't make it any easier for anybody.
Yeah, I think the truth is we don't know what's going to happen. Some things that have happened so far are definitely not moving in a positive direction for founders. You know, repealing the ACA, Obamacare helped a lot of founders, you know, really take a step out there and have the safety net to start a business in the first place. And repealing the ACA, we don't know what's going to come to replace it. It's a very scary proposition for people who want to start businesses and need healthcare. And don't know where that's going to come from or what that's going to look like. On the other hand, you know, the repatriation of capital is probably going to be a good thing. So that means that, you know, companies like Apple and Google will have more capital back in the country, and they'll need to spend it somewhere, so that M&A will eventually heat up. So that will probably be a positive. That's probably one of the few positive points, but you know, that's there.
And we always, earlier I spoke about resources, and when I look around the room and really understand the fact that we have so many entrepreneurs here present, and I think about ecosystems of support, what are some of the things you do, whether personally or within your organization, your VC, to support entrepreneurs? If there is, as an example, you know, you get that it's not the right format, what are some of the resources that entrepreneurs should look into before coming to you? And I think about people that are not connected, right? Like, do not have the social capital to understand the process. And so maybe one of those solutions is being here and learning from you. But what else is out there that they should know about to support in building their organization, one, into their network, to be in a place where they can send you an email or someone within your ecosystem?
I think one of the things I do is just trying to be as available as possible. Trying to, you know, I give people a fair amount of leeway when they're emailing me, and, you know, even if the email isn't right, I'll probably still answer. So, you know, I like to have a great email, but, you know, there are definitely times where I've gone back and forth with people just trying to get the story out. So I think, you know, that's one of the things that I do, is just trying to be as available as possible and give people as much, you know, as much benefit of the doubt as I can, because, you know, there are not a lot of Black VCs, and so a lot of people who are underrepresented in tech just don't have a lot of people who they can email and ask a question to, or say, hey, I'm building this thing, what do you think? Or, you know, I would like to pitch you. So I think having a fairly open door is the way that I've approached that.
I think for us, it's similar. Having, you know, as an entrepreneur, you kind of email a VC, you never hear back, right? And we've all had that experience, if you said it. So Kapor Capital, we respond. So 3,000 emails in, 3,000 emails out. And it's a lot of work. We can do it now because we have a larger team. But it's also part of kind of our reputation and kind of how we want to be seen to the world. Hey, it's not a good fit, but here's why. Even if it's a 2 or 3 line email, I think it's helpful because somebody gets a response. A real person took a couple minutes and looked at it and said, this is not a good fit for this reason. So that's one. I think the other is office hours. So we do have these open office hours, typically in Oakland, but we've taken them on the road now. So any large conferences like South by EU, we do office hours, mentor hours. Anybody can sign up. There's no prereq. You can be idea stage or raising a Series A. It's an open door, sign up, and somebody on the team will meet for 30 minutes, kind of give advice. And then I think, you know, the third thing, we try to do things and we try to be innovative inside. Sometimes things just don't work or don't scale. Like, we're not good at blogging, right? We're not gonna be Hunter Walk or any famous blogger, and kind of, we know it. So we try to do things that we feel like we can do pretty well, that we give back to the entrepreneurial community.
The organization, you started doing hackathons and really focus on different topics that impact communities of underrepresented backgrounds or even topics that are underrepresented. Can you share a little more about that?
Yeah, so one of the ways that if you want to see companies get started, you've got to kind of get the ecosystem going, right? So we've hosted, I think, 4 or 5 startup weekends. One of them was a Latinx startup weekend, and it was all about solving problems in your community. And we did one with high school students, and you see that there's different things that kind of come out of it, and it gives people a chance to have the mentors, to understand how funding actually works, to have great companies come out and volunteer, kind of say, hey, let us send my company, this is what we did. And it's a part of it that, like, I think we just love it, right? Like, trying to be helpful. All the companies are probably gonna be way too early, but I think down the line, a year or two, there's something there. And those things pay dividends. I can't tell you how many times an entrepreneur in the 5 years or 6 years that I've been here, I've seen it pass. This is the one. This is the one we're gonna go with, and they end up in the portfolio.
That's awesome. What have I not asked that you think our audience, and particularly entrepreneurs, need to know about the work you do? If you could have one impact tonight, what would that be?
I don't know. I mean, look, then ask us some questions.
We can jump into Q&A. I mean, that's definitely next. So
great.
If you want to, yeah, let's do that.
Yeah, I guess one more is that you gotta understand the VC is like, you see 3,000 deals, right? And like, just tell them how it is from the other side. And most times you're starting at a point of no, right? Like, you're starting at a point of like, oh, I don't really wanna do this deal, or I'm not interested in this space. And I think as an entrepreneur, it's like, this is why you should actually pay attention to this thing, because we've got this traction, because we've only been up for 2 months, and like, our engagement is just through the roof. I mean, it's those kind of hooks, because even when you have, like, at any given point, you're looking at multiple deals, and it's just priority, right? It's like, how do you move to the top of the queue? Chances are it's like a warm intro in, or this traction, or you don't want to miss it. And like, understanding that VCs do not like to be left out of things, that is a great way to use that to your advantage as a founder.
That's great. So we make it competitive for VCs. So we're going to open up the floor for questions. If you have any questions, please raise your hand. I'll come by and support you. Give you the mic. And we'll go from there. Any questions?
So a quick question for Monique. Brian actually, he had some metrics, as to what sort of deals that you were, entering into 1 million to 2 million. You know, the team should be ready. Product should be ready if possible, and people should be ready to, the team should be ready to pivot, because the first problem is never. So I would like to hear the same stuff from 500Startups for you.
Sure. So we actually invest fairly similar things, so you won't be surprised that it's very similar. So we look for teams that are fully formed. I generally like to see technical talent on the team in some sort of CTO role with an equal amount of equity split amongst the team. I look for teams with at least an MVP and something that shows me that it's working. So that's traction. And for us, that often means revenue.
if it is a consumer product, it needs a high number of users or downloads. But we generally like to see companies that have revenue or a clear path to revenue, or having had some kind of pilot projects done with a revenue producing customer. Those are really the things that we look for, that we really drill into. There are definitely areas that we don't really fund that often. We don't often, we like medical devices, we're not really doing that. They're gaming, we generally don't do gaming. Not a lot of pure social networks. So there are certainly areas, we really like fintech, healthcare. Right now we have a B2B track. We also have a beauty, fashion, retail track, a fintech track, and a digital health track. So those are certainly areas where we're very much focused, but we also invest in lots of other areas as well.
Thank you.
Anyone else? Yes.
I'm sure this is quite a difficult one to respond to, but how many of the companies that you invest in are successful? How many fail?
There are measures around this. I can't remember the matter mark.
Oh, I have the matter mark.
You do?
Yeah.
Okay, good.
So, and this is matter mark's numbers, not our numbers, but 60% of seed stage companies go out of business before they can raise a Series A round. That's from their most recent report, which is 2016 report.
And sort of following on from that, then what are the typical things that are the failure points?
Yeah.
So out of that 60%, what are the points?
I mean, the standard of product takes too long to ship. If you're kind of a pre-product or feature set just isn't there, users aren't using the product. Failed to ring the register. You're not making capital, you've got a high burn rate, which that's a great way that you won't be able to raise more money. And I think sometimes it's just like poor planning or cash flow issues is a kind of another of, hey, we're making sales, but we're burning way more capital, and we have a 90-day kind of payment terms, etc. And then I think boundary breakups is pretty common as well. And that just destroys companies, and it's hard sometimes to bounce back from that.
Yeah, I would reiterate the burn rate. I see a ton of companies coming into 500Startups, the accelerator program, with really high burn rates. And there are definitely companies where we've said, you know, we would love to make this deal, but unless you get your burn down, unless you can cut it by 50%, we're not going to make an offer. And so if they're able to cut it down, we'll make an offer. If they're not, then we don't. Because burn rates can kill your company before you can even get to the next round of funding. And then, you know, for us, we're the accelerator deal is 150K. We don't want to spend, you know, if your burn rate is 50K a month, which is ridiculous, we're a seed stage company. We're not going to have you spend a third of that 1 month burn. That just doesn't make any kind of sense. So it's really getting a handle on how you should be spending money for the stage that you're at. And I think that when you come in and you're able to be healthy and understand what you need and what you don't need, you can continue that as you continue to raise more money. Because, you know, if you raise $2 million and you're gonna burn, you know, 100K a month, that's a really crazy place to be in.
Hey, this is a question from Monique. You mentioned that there's like fintech, you know, you guys have a fintech accelerator. So I was curious if you would mind talking a little bit about your fintech accelerator.
Sure. So we have a fintech accelerator. It's attached to our fintech fund, which is run by our partner, Shiel Manat. And we take fintech companies roughly exactly twice a year in the San Francisco Accelerator. That doesn't mean that we don't take fintech companies for the Mountain View Accelerator, but it just means that the dedicated fintech track, when we bring in additional programming around
everything a fintech company needs to know around regulation, connect them with mentors that are in the financial services space, and all of the sort of extra programming that we bring to the table that happens inside the San Francisco accelerator.
So the investment that happens outside of the accelerator?
I'm sorry?
The investment that happens that go for the accelerator.
That don't go through the accelerator?
Right, yeah.
Yes, we do seed stage deals as well. And we also invest in Series A companies through our Series A program, formerly known as the Distro Dojo.
So your reservation is about 503. What is it going to take to feel comfortable with that space?
I think for me, for us, it's just knowing it more. It's very new, it's very nascent, and I'm still a little bit wary about the whole crowdfunding, equity crowdfunding space.
Yeah, I think the part of it is, it's kind of the same problems that AngelList or any crowdfunding platform went through, is that investors sometimes feel that all the good deals are kind of gone if they're going down that path. Right, so if you're a great company, chances are you can go out and raise a Series A, Series B from a name brand VC. And if you can't, then you kind of go down kind of this other route, right, or alternative route. I think at the chance, at the point where a company who has Title III funding does well, then it's like, all right, this is a real thing. But one of the problems with Title III is that it's not just about money, right? Like, Title III gets you some dollars in the bank, but hopefully you're not just taking a term sheet or investment just for the dollars. So the expertise, the connections, the, hey, we have 130 companies in the portfolio, that plan that you're thinking about doing, we saw 10 companies do it, it doesn't work, or it works. And those, I think, data points is what you don't get when you do a Title III just for dollars. I think that's one of the pitfalls of the current system. Good evening, guys. Thank you for preparing and doing this. Brian, you had mentioned before that one of the ways that companies can help fund themselves is by selling pre-orders, so especially hardware companies. And we've seen that in people that follow, say, tech news will run it, read about companies that do that and then can't build new products. So when you have that in front of you, how do you try to mitigate or say grow the founder, CTO, whoever's in front of you on, do they have their supply chain locked in? Are they going to have development problems? And you know, perhaps if you want to handle that, both of you see a lot of hockey stick graphs of growth in front of you. So pretty much every presentation is going to happen. Can you give us, this is a pitch of it, a couple of hard cues or soft cues that give you, that allows you to cut through that? Since you see so many of these, you have to shuffle so many of them all. So how do you do that? How do you believe one versus the other?
Yeah, so great question. Unfortunately, we have a real example in the portfolio of a company that went out and raised, you know, did a successful Kickstarter, raised over $1 million, and never shipped the product. It was hard, and the company shut down, and I'm not going to mention the company's name at this point. But part of it is that for hardware, you can only do so much diligence, right? Like we saw the prototypes. We knew that they had manufacturing kind of lined up. I think some of the pitfalls were they didn't have the financing that they thought they would need, wasn't there. I think some of the terms they thought they were going to get from the manufacturer wasn't there. So we should have done more work on, hey, let's see the contracts. Let's see, is there a non-compete? A lot of hardware companies want to get in the Apple store. Do they actually have a path to get there? Do they have the proper certifications, the Apple certifications to get in the Apple store? So we've learned a lot from kind of that failure point. Hardware is just way harder. And like, we've done, I think, four now. Two of them turned out pretty well, and two kind of not so well. But I think having all the ducks lined up where when you get funding that you can go out and execute, like, and showing that in the pitch ahead of time is something you can do to kind of helping the odds in your favor.
And then the second part of your question was, how do you distinguish, everyone has hockey stick growth, let me show the graph, so how do you distinguish from one company to another? And for me, I think it's really about whether they have the ability to grow beyond that. So it's really looking at that hockey stick growth and say, okay, have they topped out, have they maxed out that growth, or is there more room there for them to grow, and really thinking about the market that they're trying to get into, thinking about TAM, thinking about their ability to take a large percentage of that market. And being able to see that hockey stick growth is nice, but yeah, it's really about growth beyond the point where they are now and what they can show immediately. So I really look and think really hard about future growth more than just, oh, the graph looks great.
Hi. In your personal careers, have you ever felt that there was a conflict between a company achieving high growth and it achieving its social or environmental impacts?
Absolutely. It's probably one of the most common reasons why we don't invest. We believe you can do both, that you can have these kind of VC-like returns and at the core of the product. Not kind of a one-to-one, hey, we're going to sell this thing at $5,000 and we're going to give it away. Where when things get hard, that's the first thing to get cut. Of like, why don't we stop giving that product away? So instead, we look for things like earn-up, right? Where you're trying to help families save money on fixing loans. And the more folks that they get on their platform, the more people who are saving money. It's just a fair way to do business. As you grow, the impact grows. And that's kind of our core metric of what we're looking for. It's like, we call it bolt-on impact. Like, each bolt-on, like, hey, one-on-one, and then it goes away. That's how we kind of think about it. And I think the tough part is, sometimes you invest in a company that has core impact, and startups are hard, they pivot, they do something else, and they're no longer an impact company, but they're in your portfolio. And you make a promise when you make an investment that you're going to be for the long haul. And sometimes that means the initial vision that they had isn't the vision that they have today.
Yes.
Yeah.
When you invest money, how much of that money do you control? And do you give it up at once, or do you have to expect for something to happen before you give it up?
So we don't do tranches. So that's what it means when you say, okay, I'm going to invest $200K and I'm going to give you $50K now and another $75 at this milestone, and you know, keep going until you give the full $200. We don't invest in tranches, so we give the entire amount at one time. And what was the second?
Do you follow up with what they're doing with the money, or do you just expect?
So we get quarterly reports, and you know, for the accelerator companies, they're of course in the accelerator program, and we spend a large amount of time with them, 4 months with them. So we see them on a daily basis, do weekly check-ins, that sort of thing. For seed stage companies that are not in the accelerator, you know, there's less of a, you know, regular cadence, but you know, we expect companies to really use us to, you know, use our network, because that's really that's why you should want to check for 500 startups, because we're really good at big and we invested in a lot of companies, and so we know a lot of people. And so, you know, if you're not asking us for things or asking us, you know, to introduce you to someone or help you with a customer or something, you're probably not using it to the best of your advantage. But you know, what we only require is, you know, the quarterly reports, and then that you invite us for, you know, the next round by exercising our pro rata.
Hi,
we have time for two more questions. So,
hi. So thank you so much for talking with us as well. I actually have related questions. I have a conversation with, in terms of investing, I have a conversation with one of the investor, she is interested in so-called impact investing. So I guess the term defined as people who deploy investment money but don't expect like 10 times returns, or they expect probably 2 times or 3 times returns. I thought it's really interesting because while I came from B-school academic background, I in our class, always the financial investors are, there's only one metric there. They are driven by its X amount of returns. The higher, the better. So I'm just wondering, because both of you guys are investors, especially Brian, you just mentioned align impact with the investment returns. I'm wondering, is there a gray area in between philanthropy and the investment? Is there like middle ground you only make 2 to 3 times rather than 10 times?
Yeah, absolutely. And I think you want to find out which investor you're kind of working with or taking investment from. For us, we're very clear. We want 10x returns and impact. And we're not willing to subsidize returns for impact. We think the companies that we're investing in, you've got to do both. You've got to do both well. There's other investors that have more patient capital, where they're fine with a 2x return over 10 or 15 years. And you know, a lot of this is about kind of obviously companies raising money, but you've got to understand that VCs have to raise money too. And they're investing a pool of capital from limited partners, LPs, and they've got to go show performance and then go back out to the market and raise another fund. So if you have these investments that are 2x kind of expected return, and you're telling that and LPs are expecting 10x returns, well, that's a mismatch when you go back out to go raise. So I think there's no right or wrong answer. It's just, what pool of capital are you taking an investment from, and what's the expectation of that capital?
Got it. Thanks.
Hi. I was wondering, does it think that your decision to invest in a company when developing teams and offshore development teams?
It depends on the stage, and it depends on your long-term plan for growing out a tech team. We've certainly invested in teams that, in companies that have offshore developers, but I really like to dig in a little bit more onto what that relationship exactly looks like. Is it that you just outsource this product and then you have a product and that's it for right now? And then I also like to see that there's some plan to bring in some sort of CTO at some point who may end up managing that offshore development team. Rather than immediately hiring in-house developers. But it's not necessarily a no, but I would have a lot of questions around it, that's all.
That's very clear.
Yeah.
I think I saw somebody raise.
I saw thank you, Brian, and me for, and Martha for great conversation today. My question was, are you seeing any particular direction in terms of investment these days? I know fintech was hot for a little while. I don't know if that still continues to be the case. Are there any other industries or sectors that you see really moving forward?
Well, we're still really excited about fintech. I don't like to get too deep into what's hot or not right now. I think, you know, sentiment wanes among VCs, and I really like to get outside of the Silicon Valley echo chamber and just figure out what people actually want and what they actually want to pay for. So I think, you know, chatbots are hot, or AI is hot, or this thing is hot, and so every VC kind of rushes in and drives up valuations, and I think it's really, for other VCs, it's really good to be at a table where it's maybe less hot because, you know, there's still hands being played there, there's still money to be made. So I think that I try to not just follow what's hot. I think that a lot of the things that people, consumers, want remain the same. But I think the delivery is what changes. So maybe it was AI, but now it's a chatbot, or maybe it was delivered via web, and now it's mobile, or now it's IoT. Those are just different delivery systems. But what really gets down to the
the base level of what people actually want remains very similar. And so really trying to show them and figure out what that is how you find the winners. But yeah, there are certain areas that are still really interesting to invest in, fintech especially, digital health especially, and tech certainly. But I'm less influenced by what's hot and hopefully have my own sort of point of view.
So we'll take one last one, and then we'll move in to have the companies that actually came to pitch do that.
Thanks. So my question is, I guess, at the start of 2021, how many, are there any even that have CEOs that are also technical? And is that a red flag to see someone who is the CEO, but really their specialization is wisdom technology, but they build the product?
Is a red flag to that?
To see a CEO whose specialty is really technology, but still wants to be the CEO.
No, I think there are a lot of really good technical CEOs. That's not necessarily a red flag at all. We love technical CEOs. I also am a fan of non-technical CEOs who can get technical things done. And whether that's by bringing on really great and hiring really great technical talent, or by just figuring some other way to get it done. And yes, we have backed lots of technical CEOs and who have kept that CEO position. I think, isn't Jeff from Twilio technical CEO? So is Drew from Dropbox. So I think there are lots of really good examples of technical CEOs who have managed to remain in that position and build really big companies.
Well, thank you. Let's, yeah, thank you.